Hello and welcome to the very first episode of Go Travel and Train. My name is Mark and today we are in Sandnes in Norway, where we'll visit Andre, the owner of City 24/7. Sandnes is located on the west coast of Norway and it's approximately 305 kilometers away from Oslo, the capital of Norway. It lies immediately south of Stavanger, the fourth largest city in Norway, and together the Stavanger and Sandnes area is the third largest urban area in Norway. Here's what I found out about Sandnes and what Sandnes has to offer the visitors and guests looking for a place to stay and things to do. Public transport for both the trains and buses arrive here in Sandnes city centre, and from here you can make your way to your booked accommodation or hotel. Three hotels that are within walking distances are Quality Hotel Residence, Hotel Sverre and Gamle Verke. Now, if you're cheap like me, you can check out their prices on booking.com, where you can see which ones offer no prepayment, free cancellation, or include breakfast. Sandnes has a lot to offer, including shopping malls, libraries, museums, parks, hiking areas, a cinema, and not too far away, some farms. In the center of Sandnes, there's a science factory called Vitenfabriken. It has great educational activities for children to learn and have fun. They do, however, have different opening hours during the summer and winter, so please check out their website before you make your way down there. 10 minutes south of Sandnes is Kongeparken, another child-friendly activity for children between the ages of 3 and 12 years old, and they offer over 60 different rides and amusements. You will easily spend a whole day there. Okay, guys. So as I stated earlier, we are now in the City Gym and or City 24/7 in Sandnes, and the owner of that gym is Andre Thessen. And Andre, hello and welcome to the Travel and Go.
This is our
first episode, and of course it would only be natural for me to come here first. This is where I train. You're the guy that took me under your wing when I first come here to ask you about bodybuilding.
Yeah, I remember that, eh?
Yeah.
I remember it very good. Because it was a common friend of us who said, hey, I have a friend.
Yes.
Do you remember Christoph?
Oh, it was Christoph. I couldn't remember who it was.
He came and said, hey, I have this friend.
Yeah.
He wanted to, if you could have a look a little bit, because he's really into the bodybuilding.
Yeah.
If he could bring you someday. And I said, yeah, sure, take him, like, because I have people that ask me 10,000 times, I know a guy, or I know. So I said, yeah, I didn't think more about that. And a couple of weeks after, then he came, hey, my friend is here now, could you please have a look at it and see? Yeah, sure, just give me a minute, I'll be there, you know, behind the...
Oh, the curtains, yeah.
So, and I came back there, and you were standing there. Hey, fuck. Are you asking me, you know, if you can compete in bodybuilding?
But I honestly didn't know, because I knew I had like lots of weight classes.
I was staring at it, is there a camera or something? that was the first day, and after that we had a really good, the next year there.
Yeah.
Me and you and a couple of other guys, we were training together. Yeah. We did a competition in 2011.
That's right, 2011 was the first one, yeah.
So maybe when I'm looking back now, those was my best years.
Really?
Yeah, but into the training, because we were really hardcore at that time.
That's true, yeah.
And for me, that is the golden era in bodybuilding down there, you know, from 2007 until 2013, 2014, 2015, those years was really the good era. We had some good years there.
Every time we talk about this, I always remember the first leg day training that I did with you. Oh my
God!
I thought I trained legs, but no.
That was the time we were laying there on the floor. You know. I always remember you were not looking forward to the leg training.
Yeah.
Two more legs.
But
it was you couldn't skip it.
That's right.
You have to go through it.
Yes, that's right. And I think that was part of the problem. I knew I couldn't get out of it.
But it is always like that, you know.
Yeah.
taste, you know. It's it was a good time. Really.
I was on that first leg day. I was on the bus. I had to take the bus home, and I swear to God, I was this close to tears. I tell you what actually saved me. I had to go back to work. Right. And because, of course, I had clients and they needed me to follow them around. Right. I think if I didn't keep walking that day, I'd have locked up. I'd kid you not. So,
we had some good years.
We trained hard. We really pushed each other.
Yeah, we did.
But you have been training for many years, long before before I can see you.
Yeah.
So how did that start? How did that happen?
I'm starting the training now 30 years ago. But then there was another gym there.
Yeah.
And that was a good gym. It's most quite the same as we have here now.
Yeah.
But a different type, not the same, but you know, some kind of. But they closed it, and all the guys started training there, and somebody there, and blah, blah, blah.
Okay.
And we ended up in a sports club, what is SATS now. And then, but we were always talking about starting our own thing again.
Okay.
To get a gym where we. Boys could be boys, and these things. And there was me and two brothers, Bjarte and Jona, okay. We were talking about this every time we went to the NASP or something.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we have to do something, but when we wake up Sunday, not this week. But finally we start up, their father, Bernd, he helped us with the financial. We go to the bank and get a little help from there. He helped us borrow some money, and the idea was that we just were supposed to find a place, buy some old equipment,
okay.
Get a place, talking with our 100 closest friends, the 100 guys that you know we'd train in a place like that,
of course.
Make copies of some keys, mm-hmm. And just have a place to train, and we wash the gym together, and do everything, but it was not meant to something business.
Okay, right.
But and then we find this, not this place, but inside the gym.
Yeah.
And instead of buying some old equipment, we talked with the guy who was an agent for Panatta, the Italian label that most of the gym still are.
Yeah, that's right.
Panatta. And he gave us a good price on a basic package of gym equipment,
okay.
And of course we knew what we want, so we picked out what we really need, what is most basic for the ID that we have for training. So
perfect.
And we bought that, but after a while we there are a little bit of businesses, you know. If you want to get rich, don't buy a gym. but we saw that we could do something, and all of us was working offshore out in the North Sea at that point. So we were working with this when we were home, and we had a job offshore.
Yeah.
And after a while, a few years, this was around 2003, 2004.
Okay.
Starting up.
Yeah.
And then we have developed from there.
Yeah.
And I've never been. Then we had already been training for a few years, of course, in the other gym, and we start training here. And after only a couple of years, I started to think about the competition.
Okay.
When we had this other gym, there were a lot of people into the competition also there.
Yeah.
But when we started here, it was supposed to be a place for people who want to compete in bodybuilding and other fitness. And the other fitness stuff.
Yeah.
So it started off here from day one, but it took a couple of years before I self went into it.
Okay.
And then I started my career on the stage, and I had my debut in my local, call it, I don't know the English word, just for us in the gym, we call it City Open.
Oh yeah, okay.
We have it in the basement here.
Oh, cool.
You know, it was really cool.
Where was that located then?
Down in the cellar here, in the building next
downstairs,
door.
Downstairs, yeah. Yeah, okay.
So that was really, when we see into it today, today it's...
it's coming.
Yeah, it was, but it was really good. You remember, we had it, what did we have? We make it a small stage.
Mm-hmm.
We have some judges here because they have been judging into the national competition.
Yeah.
They came here and we just... borrow some shares, we borrow some data, this and that, and we have this, it was so cool.
That was nice.
We have this a couple of years, and the year after,
yeah.
first year, I think that was 2005, 2006.
Yeah.
Then we had the city open again. Then we had another place, just in the neighborhood.
Yeah.
And then we did the same thing, but then we did a little bit more out of it. We asked Tommy Torvaldsen.
Oh yeah.
If he can come down and, you know, have guest hosting and, you know, he had this seminar.
He was pro at the time, right?
Yeah. Or, yeah. You know, Tommy was for us. He was, you know, our god.
For
you
sure.
Know, yeah. So that was really good. But we had a lot of people.
Okay.
You know, in the same time, they had a world championship in powerlifting in Stavanger.
Okay.
But actually, we had more audience here than we had in the powerlifting world championship.
Okay.
Okay. We had it for free, but you know, a lot of people, right. All our families were coming and sharing. Still this small stage and borrow some light and get some, you know.
That's how we did it.
Was trying to take the deadlift record. Yeah. And, it was really little back to basic. Yeah. And I thought,
What years was that?
It's 2005, 2006, those years, 2004, around that there.
Awesome,
And then when I also started to go to the nationals,
mm-hmm.
and went to the national and we had Stavanger open.
Yeah. Didn't you have a nickname back then?
Me?
Yeah, because you used to get in shredded condition, right?
They called me Mr. Ripped. Different nicknames in that setting.
Yeah.
No, I was at that time. Now I know better, but at that time I always went very hard.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
For example, you know, when we have this peak, we have this basic thing we do.
Yeah.
And the guys who were helping me a little bit, he said, okay, these days you drink 7-8 liters of water.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. But okay, if I drink more, then I will be better. So actually, one day, I drink 13 liters of water.
Jeez.
That's dangerous. That's dangerous.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. Okay, say 8. Okay, I do 13. Yeah. You know?
How did your body respond to that?
You're living on the toilet.
Yeah.
You are.
Yeah.
It's not once an hour you go to the toilet.
Constantly.
It's every 10 minutes.
Yeah, it's just coming through. Yeah.
But I was really good shape, because when I started, my first debut was like in athletic fitness.
Okay.
And that was on this City Open. The next year in City Open, I was into the bodybuilding, and then to my first national. Then they had make this classic bodybuilding. That was the first time in Norway they had the classic bodybuilding.
Okay.
And that was my class.
Okay.
I really like it. And I'm really loving it now. It's I like the ideas.
Yeah.
With the classic bodybuilding, I think there are lots of people here in Norway who can do the classic bodybuilding.
Yeah.
You know,
it makes
really,
sense.
It really is. Because I think if a guy are 175 centimeters high, then you can be 79 kilos. Mm-hmm. And I think there are lots of guys around that height who can come in a good shape, 75, 79 kilos.
Yeah.
It's all up to you if you really want to. Mm-hmm. But I was there a year. My last competition in classic bodybuilding was in 2010 in Sandefjord, and that's in Sandefjord and Oslo Grand Prix that year. And that's probably my best shape it's not that competition I'm most satisfied with my shape and condition, but I was really ripped.
Do you remember what you weighed then? Sorry, did I miss that?
I guess it's around, I don't know. 77, 78 kilos or something. And after that, I take a short break, but another long break, because I was competing almost every year.
Okay.
But then I went into the minus 90.
Okay.
And I had my debut in minus 90 in Stavanger Open in the September 2011.
Oh, yes.
That was my first.
Yes. So that was your first minus 90?
That was my first minus 90. And then I really did some good work until that, because when I was in the classic, you know, I pushed myself hard, so when I was 77, 78, I was really pushed down. I remember I was standing here with the Stein, I'm one of the judges we had in the gym.
Yeah.
I was standing there, and he had a look at me, on my shape, a couple of weeks before the competition, and then I was 83, and he said, where are you going to...
Nothing more to lose.
I got to show it. I came in, I'm 77, 78, or whatever.
Jesus.
So when I get into the minus 90, then I was going for more rip, but more filled, you know.
Yes.
So I was like 10 kilos more heavier than September 2011, okay, comparing to the April 2010.
Yeah.
And then I was into the minus 90 class in until 2017 was my 60, I don't remember.
Yeah.
Was my last Oslo Grand Prix, 2016 or 17.
Yeah.
Maybe it was 17, yeah.
Okay.
Minus 90. And then I went to the European Championship in 2017, a couple of weeks after Oslo Grand Prix, but then I pushed me down.
Yeah.
Pushed me down again to the classic bodybuilding. So I went into the classic bodybuilding class as the European Championship.
Yeah.
And I made it quite well there. I took a bronze medal in my class, and I also took a bronze medal in mixed pair with Ariel.
Oh yes,
I remember.
Yes, she's living now in LA. Yeah.
If LA, if you
listen to
this,
2 weeks to coordinate your pose.
Yeah, before the Oslo Grand Prix, then we had a couple of weeks before the European.
Yeah, okay, then, okay. But did you do the same pose at each? Did you say
the same show? Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
She was totally 100% control of the show.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
Yeah, she was definitely
better.
So. Yeah, fair enough. No, my last level competition then was. Then I was back in the classic, and
okay,
with my age and everything, it's natural.
I was going to ask you,
you know, it's the age is it is what it is, and, it's hard to keep on the muscle when you're getting older. That's the way that you really have to work to keep on the muscle. And of course, you can build muscle. Of course, don't misunderstand it. But I came to a point. Okay, I'm satisfied if I'm going to compete, because it's not a big difference for me. Because in classic, I can be 81.5 kilos.
Okay.
And normally I was in the minus 90, I was between 85 and 88, 89.
Okay.
At my very best, that was in Arnold Classic 2013, when we were down in Spain in Arnold Classic.
Yeah.
That is the, when we were Arnold Classic, that was my third competition, because it was starting open, the national, and then the Arnold.
Yes, there was a lot.
And the condition I was in Arnold Classic, that is definitely the shape and condition I'm more satisfied with, you know.
Okay, so
that hard, ripped, filled. And I my weight in the registration was, I think it was 88.9.
Okay.
My last competition, that was in 2019.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was in Oslo Grand Prix, and then I in a class of bodybuilding, and then I went to the European Championship. And then it's a good thing, because that I won my class. And I also won the overall in the master classes, you know. So I'm actually the oldest guy who had won the overall title.
Is that right?
Yeah, it was a note in some IFB story of the year or whatever it was.
Fantastic, yeah, okay.
So it's, that was a good thing, you know.
Yeah.
It's,
do you mind if I ask how old you were?
Now?
No, then.
No, then I was 50, 51 years old.
Fantastic.
Yeah, so I was in the 50 plus 50, you know, I was the youngest guy. Plus 50.
Yeah.
I remember this guy on 40, he was really pissed off. Really. At me. You know, that's the funny thing. Of course, they may be pissed off on judges, but they get pissed off on you because they don't agree.
Yeah.
And I saw pictures and I think, what are you crying about? I was going to eat them to breakfast.
I understand what you're saying.
I think it was fair, but that was a good thing. And I was supposed, then I was qualified to the World Championship the next 2 years.
Okay.
But then COVID came.
Right.
And then they cancelled the because I was supposed to go to the World Champion the year after.
Okay.
In November, December 2020. But they cancelled it.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Next year, and then I sort of lose my drive.
Motivation.
And I have to be realistic now where I am in the training, because the last thing I did was the overall as European Champion. It's hard to get any better.
Yeah.
Yes, I can go to the World Champion and make it, win or not. But now I have to do the qualifiers. Then I have to go through the national.
Okay.
And then to the World Championship.
Okay.
And then I have to start with the prep and everything. Maybe like in June. Then I have to go the whole summer to go to the national in September. Mm. Then for qualifying to the World Championship, who maybe is in November, December, whatever.
Mm.
I don't have the motivation to go the whole summer. You know, I have a family, I have kids, and
Because
I have to, all this year, all this competition, and because of my beautiful wife, home, who has supported me, yeah, but that's, you know, it's a cliche, but
it makes a difference.
We have brought to the world two kids in this period when I'm doing competition.
The
depends what you mean with serious.
What have you classed as serious, really?
Yeah. I think maybe the first serious was this guy I was starting the gym with, one of his brothers, Bjarte.
Yeah.
Me and him trained good together. That was maybe my first, over some
time.
Yeah, the training. Yeah. And we were good friends, that's why we did that.
Yeah.
So it's that's when we started the gym. I think that,
Fair enough. And why did you get into bodybuilding?
Why?
Yeah. Back in the day, who did you admire, and has that changed now? Is there people that you look up to now that are different to then? So who did you look up to back in the day?
I never looked up to these big Olympia guys. Yeah. Like me said, when we started this gym, Tommy was one of the big guys, and he also a very nice personality and everything. So he was, we looked up to him because he was down to the earth guy. He was, he was coming here talking to us. He, Thomas Delander, Justin Ertegaard, those guys who were the best bodybuilders in the country at that moment.
Yeah.
They helped us. Perfect. Thomas also helped us a lot, with the nutrition at that time, because he was working in protein fabrication.
Yeah.
He was recommending, with the Panatta equipment. We went up to his gym in Tromsø to have a look around. So, they took care of us.
Yeah.
So those were the guys.
Perfect. Yeah.
Because I want to be like that.
Yes. Yeah.
I mean, I'm not who the guy who's the biggest. That's not what the most important thing.
It's personal.
And I see, like Tommy, who have been dedicated to the sport and also much the same as me. I have his own gym, his own nutrition, and everything. So it's those guys. You stand, especially you stand. And Thomas Delander and Tommy Thomas, in that time, because before that it was just the guys I saw in the magazines I have an English mother, so of course there are Dorian Yates. And when Dorian Yates was there, we had a seminar, and we spent the whole weekend there.
Yeah.
And he was so down to earth, it was really fun and great to be with him. So I think,
So you've had Dorian Yates here, but you've also had Branch Warren here. Here when Branch Warren was here. Anyone else?
Not of that kind of level. We've been lucky. We've been using ourselves because we have so many top athletes.
Yes. We have Ole Christian Vorga.
He's still training here.
Yeah, he's still training here.
Maureen Blankisco.
That's right.
So it's
Ariel.
Yeah. And we have me and you and Neil, when you're working on Toto.
Toto was another one, yes.
The list is long.
Yes.
I think with the coaching business and everything, we have out of this gym 300-400 athletes all these years all together.
Fantastic.
So that's
that's something to be proud of.
Yeah, it is. And many of them are 100% training here, but some of them are, of course, when the bikini class and the men's physique classes come, then the coaching went into a business thing.
Yeah.
And some of the people who are doing the coaching from here, they of course have athletes maybe living other places, but they're going for a team. But I think that most of the people, especially in back, they were training here.
Yeah.
And the first year, people asked if they could compete for a team, living other places, training other places. I said, nope, not at all. If you want to compete for us, then you have to train up.
Yeah.
Don't finish. No question.
Fair enough.
But then the business came, and then it was hard.
That's fair. Yeah, I understand that. Uh-huh.
Because it was not the business coaching, we were just helping each other.
Yeah.
And that's also, when I'm talking about Tommy and Stalanda and Ustani, they were helping us.
Yeah.
And when they were helping me and other guys there, we helped the next guys again.
Right.
So, so if we were, it was getting paid.
What's that?
That's the way it is. Yeah. That's the way it is.
Uh-huh. So what would you consider to be your most memorable or proudest moments competition-wise?
Of course, it's hard not to say when I was overall champion in the European Championship. Of course, but I'm never going to forget the shape I was in the Honor Classic. That was most satisfied. Neil was coach.
Yeah.
He wake me up two o'clock in the night. To have a look at my shape. And he looked and he said, "You have to eat 60 grams of oatmeal. Try."
Yeah. Oh,
nothing but just 60 grams of oatmeal With nothing, water, nothing.
Oh, yo, yo.
I was sitting there.
Oh, fuck. How on earth did you get that down?
Is this really necessary? Maybe it was, maybe it was not.
Yeah, it was. It was not, yeah.
But moments like that. That's, yeah. Because that is a, moments like that show me the dedication we had for really doing our best to get in our best shape. Yeah. You know? It's always with a facet, when we see afterward, we can have a look at ourselves and oh, we could have been better for this and the shape and the posture and everything. But there, at that moment, I really did what I had to do and I was told to or whatever.
Exactly how it should be.
And that, moment like that, that outmean moment, I'm never going to forget.
Yeah.
Of course, never.
Yeah. But that's important, though, to trust your coach, your trainer 100%. Because, you know.
Yeah, definitely.
Your favorite training session, as in the one you look forward to the most in the week, because you've been known as the leg Nazi. But
I'm sorry to say it's not that anymore.
Yeah.
It's not what it's supposed to be with leg training.
Yeah.
But I'm always being fun of like the chest, back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it must be good chest, like a body back. A common mistake that you see over and over again in the gym?
It's the back exercise, maybe.
Yeah?
The back exercise.
In what respect? Technique or?
Yeah, technique.
Too much weight?
Yeah, bad technique, too much weight.
Yeah.
Then really forget to have the focus on the back.
Okay.
You know, to up with your chest, as it really using your back to get the
mind muscle connection.
Definitely. I think that's maybe is.
I think that comes down to a part of because sometimes with some exercises you feel strong enough, so you think you can manage it.
Yeah.
And then without really realizing it, unless you've either recorded yourself, you can see yourself in a mirror, or you've got someone to tell you.
Yeah.
You can't really see sometimes that you should probably drop a little bit of weight and just focus on staying
in the last 10 years. I've really had focus on that. Focus on the technique instead of on the weights.
And is there a reason for that? Is it, you have an injury?
Yeah, I had this prolapse in my neck.
Okay.
It don't bother me now, but when I get it, then I really have to start thinking about my training, how I did it, and then I have to train around it and learn, and now my strength is okay. But it's and then in when I get that, then I really have to start, because pushing around all the weights and this and that, then I have a problem.
Okay, here's the toughest ones of all now. Okay. Dorian Yates or Ronnie Coleman?
For me, Dorian Yates.
Dorian Yates, okay. Phil Heath or Kai Greene?
Phil Heath.
Flex Wheeler or Dexter Jackson?
Flex Wheeler.
Lee Priest or Franco Colombo?
Colombo.
Hey! Andre, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Cheers, man.
If you enjoy hiking, then this one's for you. Around 10 minutes drive outside of Sandnes is a place called Dalles Newton. It's a 323 meter walk to the peak. From there, you can overlook Sandnes and parts of Stavanger. You can do like I did and just walk to the top, take your time, have a look around, and then come back down. Or you can continue and follow the signs for a roughly 3-hour round trip. I would advise that you bring good walking boots or shoes and plenty of food and water. Surprisingly, Rogaland has a lot of beaches, but the one I'm going to mention today is Sula Beach, or locally called Sula Stranden. It's 2.3 kilometers long with a hotel and a golf club, and from Sandnes, it would take approximately 15 to 20 minutes to drive.